Good morning, everybody. Thank you very much for having me as one of your speakers on the BGO. Thank you, Kevin, for inviting us. Today, we will talk about the long cane production of raspberries in substrate. And we will just go through the whole process of from the beginning till the fruiting, and I will explain some of the highlights and some of the pitfalls of the of this system. And then we just go for the beginning till the end at one go, and at the end we'll have a time for some questions if necessary. The long cane production starts, of course, with the production of the young plants. We start with raspberry roots that are grown in pots, and then those pots are cut into pieces, placed on beds, on ridges, and then covered with substrates. Mostly it's covered with a layer of coir, and then later on the root system can start developing new shoots, as you can see here, and those shoots can then be cut out of the substrate and be dipped into new pots. You can see this here, some beds covered with coir. The right hand side, very nice, you can see the next phase already. That is a strawberry model plantation. That so this glasshouse is used for in the early spring for tips of raspberries, and later on for mother or young plant production of strawberries. I told about the cover of the root system with the coir. And first I wanted to tell something about coir, because we see quite a lot of misunderstandings in coir, what it is exactly, and what do we have to take in account when we work with coir. First, coir, we have three different products. We have the so-called coir pit, what is the dust, the coir dust. We have the coir fiber. We have the coir chips, and there's a lot of misunderstanding. People talk about coir fiber and they mean coir pit. So I just wanted to split those three apart so we know what we're talking about. When we talk about coir, we are always talking about the coir pits. If it's fiber or chips, it will be indicated separately. The young plants will always be covered with the coir pits. And for the coir pit, it's important that you have the right coir, that you make sure that you have a good, well-buffered coir. It must be old enough. If it's too young, it can decay a little bit, or that can lead to harmful ingredients in the substrate. And if it is not treated properly or not produced properly, you also can have human pathogens inside, or weeds or whatever. So it needs to be treated and checked very well. And the most important thing that we see that goes wrong sometimes is the buffering. Everybody has heard about buffering of coir, but I think it's good to explain again what it is exactly. The coir itself, it does have a so-called adsorption complex. The coir itself, it is negatively loaded, so it will attract the positive loaded elements like potassium, like sodium, calcium, magnesium. And depending on what is buffered, what is adsorbed exactly in the coir, leads to its influence on what is in the watery solution all around it. And before coir can be used properly, it needs to be buffered, as we call it. And this buffering is done with calcium. But first here, at the right-hand side, you see the darker part, you see that's the coir itself. You see there's a lot of sodium, a lot of potassium, and in the watery solution all around it, you also find a lot of sodium, potassium, chloride, and so on. What they normally do, what they do as a standard with coir, is they flush it with water. So they add water from the top. All the water in the solution, in the watery solution, in the liquid around the coir will be flushed out. So the salt level will be very low. It's just that inside the coir, all those potassium and sodium is still available. It's still there. You cannot wash it out with straight water. That is why if you want to clean the coir properly, you'll have to add something that replaces the sodium and the potassium. So what should be done is you should give, or the supplier of the coir should give, an overdose of calcium, calcium nitrate mostly used, and this calcium will replace the sodium and the potassium in the coir. So if you add the calcium, you will see that the calcium goes inside the complex, inside the coir complex. It will push out the sodium and potassium, and then there is no risk anymore that you get an overdose of potassium and sodium out of your coir. Of course, once it is treated, the calcium, you will find a lot of potassium and sodium in the solution, in the coir, so that needs to be flushed out with water as well. So that you need to flush out with water after it has been treated with the calcium. To find out whether this buffering treatment has been done correctly, we can do the so-called barium chloride analysis method. And in this method, they take a sample of the coir. They do analyze it like always in the laboratory. So mix it with water and analyze what is inside. And then with the same sample, they use it, they put an overdose of barium chloride. And the barium will be attracted even stronger to the coir than the calcium. So it will push out all the rest of the sodium, all the potassium, and also the calcium, magnesium, everything. So in the end, this coir will be filled completely with barium, and all the other cations will be released. And then by analyzing again this sample with the barium chloride extraction, you can see how much was left in the coir. So at the top part here, this is analyzed with just water, just a standard analysis. You can see, as an example here, the potassium was 0.3. And then after the treatment with the barium chloride, they analyze it again, and they find here 1.2. So that means in the complex, there was a rest of 0.9. 1.2 minus 0.3, 0.9. And for the sodium, you can see in the watery solution, first they found 0.4. After the treatment with the barium chloride, they analyzed 0.7. So in the complex, there was 0.3 left. In this way, you can analyze how good was the buffering process. And for us to be suitable for soft fruit production, this complex may contain a maximum of 2.0 of potassium and 1.0 of sodium. If those values are higher, it means that there is too much sodium and potassium left in the complex, and that will lead to high salinity after you start with the fertigation, and also to a disbalance in the cations. So that's important to use always the right coir with the right treatment. Go back here. Also, at the left-hand side, you can see the coir contains quite a bit of fibers. For covering this kind of root systems, we use a fiberless coir, as less fiber as possible. Because if the people are working all day, after a while, they'll start complaining about the sharp edges of the fiber. It must be as fiber-free as possible. Then, of course, we start cutting the cuttings and tipping them in a substrate. The substrate for this, what we use mainly, is a 50-50 mix. 50% of coir with 50% fine white peat from blocks. And that leads to, at the end, it should lead to a plant like this. A new trend that we see is the use of allopods for this. Some big growers have bought their own machinery to produce pots like this. And I think in Canada, most growers will buy the finished product. I know that AMA is supplying those as well. Just you can buy them as a finished product and use this for tipping your raspberries. But what you see here is not a raspberry block, it's a strawberry one. For the raspberries, we would not recommend to use the perlite inside, because it is quite difficult to tip this very delicate, soft raspberry cutting in a substrate that contains fibers or that contains perlite. The advantage of these allopods is that you get lower mortality rates. It sticks together better, and if the pot is not 100% completely rooted and you take the plant out, it will still stick together. And I think most big professional tip producers in the Netherlands are now shifting towards this system with the allopods. You can see again, it's also, there's a lot of air around because it's not, the tray is not completely filled. You get a nice aeration all around those blocks as well. So it gives you a very nice root system. Here, the plants with the normal system still looking very nice. One of the big or two big risks in the production of young plants like this, like tips, is one, it is, you must, of course, irrigate them very intensively, do use a lot of fogging to make sure that they do not dry out where they still have no roots left or no roots yet. But you may not overdo it. What you see here is problems with botrytis due to too intensive fogging. So you must fog as much as needed to make sure that plants survive, but not so much that they stay humid all the time because you get a lot of botrytis problem. And the second thing here is they do need some feed. If you do not feed those plants at all, they will stay yellow, they will not grow at all. So they need a decent feed schedule, but not too intensive overhead irrigation. Plants like this, then in when the night frost, when the frost period, the frost risk is gone, they are then transplanted in pots. This is an old picture where we see one plant per pot, but after a while, the head will be taken out and they grow two laterals from one plant. But it's a bit the old fashioned way of doing it nowadays. We see more and more that you just put two plants in one pot, pot of 1.8 to 2 liters, and two plants pot, two canes per pot is the standard. There have been done some trials of three plants per pot to reduce the costs of the pots, of the substrate, etc. But the risk is that if one plant, one cane doesn't perform, you miss three plants, of course. The standard is mostly just two plants per 1.8 liter pot. For this, we use two types of substrate. The conventional way is to use coir with a little bit of extra coir fiber added. The other way, that's mainly for the delicate varieties with like sapphire that have quite often their root problems, we use the coir plus an addition of peat and perlite because it's just safer for the plants to grow, because it's the peat makes it chemically more forgiving, the perlite makes it more airy. The block peat addition gives you also an extra buffer for your pH. And the perlite, as I say, it's a higher air-filled porosity. This extra pH buffer, I thought this slide was coming, but it's the next one. But if you do not have a pH buffer, you can see this here. If the plant takes up a lot of nitrate, it will set free a lot of OH minus, a lot of base, and that will bring up the pH. And that's especially in these cases here. In the beginning, the plants grow very massively. Because they grow so fast, they take up a lot of nitrate, and that brings up the pH. And you can see here that leads to trace elements, mainly iron deficiency. And if you add peat moss to such a mix, you create a higher buffer for your pH. And in the peat moss, there's a lot of humic and fulvic acids. And you can see there's here a lot of H's at the end and OH's. What means that if it is that they act like weak organic acids, if the pH of the substrate goes up, such a fulvic acid can release an H plus, and that brings the pH back down. If the pH goes down, it will take up, absorb H plus, so it will not, like that, the pH doesn't fluctuate as much as when you would have, for instance, 100% perlite that has no buffer at all. And at the right-hand side, you can see the buffering capacity of different raw materials. And as an example, we express this, it's a complicated story, we express the milli equivalent per liter. Coir has a pH buffer of around about 7 milli equivalent per liter. If you have peat moss, depending on where it comes from, depending on the origin, between 17 and 23, 24. So it's a much higher buffer for your pH. So if you make a mistake in your irrigation, or your plants grow very fast, or during harvest you need a lot of potassium, that always has it in its influence on the pH. But it does not have this big influence if you have a peat addition in your substrate. Back to those spots with those two plants here at the nursery. Nice new development is these trays where they are lifted from the ground, that you have the guarantee that there is no contact between the plants, between the roots and the soil. It guarantees a very free drainage. Here again, it's a very nice system to work like this. Some pictures about the development of those plants placed on fields outside with trellising, of course, to guide the plants during the growth period. They develop during summertime, autumn. They get bigger and bigger. At this stage, we do a feed recipe what is quite growth stimulating. You see levels 1.5, 1.8 with pH levels of 5.5, 5.8. Quite common nowadays is not to do this in one line, but to use the V system. If you grow them in a V system, we can get a little bit higher plant density per hectare and a very good light levels inside the plants as well. So you get a little bit a more compact plants and more buds per meter. So root systems as they develop during the autumn time. Then it's later autumn, we top them. The height that we want is about 1.8 meters. Because with 1 meter 80, it's still easy to store them in the big bins. If you plant them, they do not get too high. You have enough internodes per meter of plant length. So we see 1 meter and 80 centimeters as an optimum height for the plants. In the autumn time, they will, of course, start, you go down with your fertigation, days get shorter and they will start yellowing and you'll have the plants, to help the plants a little bit of getting rid of their leaves. The left-hand side, you see de-leafed plants for very early storage in September, October, that we do for production in Portugal, Spain, in the very south of Europe. They want to plant very early. They only need a very short storage, but they must be de-leafed. So that's done artificially by machinery and by hand as well. The right-hand side, it is more natural later on in the season. That will be a picture from November or something. But even then, if you want to store them, you will have to de-leaf those plants by machine, by hand, because you do not want any green leaves into the storage. Here the plants are then packed in bins. If it is cold enough, you can pack them in plastic in one time. So plastic bags in the bins and put the plants inside. But quite often it is not cold enough and they do this plastic only later on. In this case here, they are still quite green. This will be this summer, or this September, October storage for production in the southern part of Europe. Again, plants in the 2 meter long bins. And it's important, as I say, especially for the longer storage, to have them packed in plastic as on the right hand side. But if the temperatures are too high, if the plants are too warm, they need to be pre-cooled before they are packed in the plastic. So that's very important, because if you put them in plastic in a cold store and the plants are +5, +10, they will still be so active that they create their own warmth. And it will be very difficult to get the temperatures down. So what to do then is put them in boxes, pre-cool them, make sure you get around about zero, and then wrap them in plastic with, as you can see here, holes in the plastic for extra ventilation. It may not be completely closed because that would lead to botrytis. It needs to be a perforated plastic that there can still be some aeration, also to avoid buildup of gas like ethylene. Then storage plants need to be stored below zero. If you store them above zero, they will continue to develop, and you can see here at the right hand side, buds will start to grow and you lose a lot of potential growth or potential power in those plants. So they must be stored below zero. And it's written here, it was a trial at minus 1.5, but I think minus 1.5 is really the absolute minimum. It should be between minus 0.5 and optimally minus 1.5 in centigrades, what is 31 Fahrenheit. That should be the optimum storing temperature. And then if you store too warm, you'll have problems with botrytis, like you see here and here. That is too much plant activity in storage. And if you store them too cold in ice, like you see on the right-hand side here at the top, it will lead to cracked canes, but also has its influence on the power and the strength of the growth. Then after cold storage, they are then planted. If I look back to the past, we did this initially with very coarse white peat from block peat, very coarse fractioned peat, what had a lot of air inside. It's about 10, 15 years ago, we came off of this and we went more and more to coir substrate to be used for this. And nowadays again, if you have a little bit of a delicate variety, a difficult variety, it is better to use a coir peat perlite mix for this. And we see those two lines. We see growers using coir with extra fiber added, and we see the growers that want to be on the safe side to use a coir peat perlite mix. Traditionally, of course, it's about 6 canes per meter, so that means 3 pots per meter. Pot sizes varying from 7 to 10 liters. 7.5 liters is quite a bit of a standard right now. Here it starts growing. You see the rain cover. All long canes should always be covered. Never do this outside. It needs always its cover. And of course, it needs a very good fertigation. And that's quite important to make sure that you have the right fertigation schedule. This is only an example. Don't write these figures because they are, of course, very depending on the fresh water quality. That determines what kind of fertilizer you need to get you to your feed schedule. But what I wanted to say here is you must make sure those plants, the long canes, when you plant them, they start growing very fast. They take huge amounts of nitrogen. So this really needs a fertigation schedule with high amounts of nitrogen. And to make sure that the plant takes up enough nitrogen, that there's enough nitrogen available, we cannot work only with nitrate, but normally we would work as much with nitrate as possible. But with the long canes, especially in the beginning, we also need a bit of ammonium because the plant takes the ammonium easier than the nitrate. And every individual bud will start to grow, will first start to develop a leaf and needs enormous amounts of nitrogen. So that's why in this kind of cultivation system with the long canes, we do quite a bit of ammonium in the beginning as well. And of course, when it grows, we have our systems with our nets to avoid the kinking of the laterals, or with ropes, but it's more standard right now. What you see here is at this moment a bit the standard as we do it in Europe. 3 pots per meter with 2 canes per pot, with ropes on the sides to prevent the kinking of the laterals, always covered. And this is a mini air from Meteor, but it's really very popular at the moment in Europe because of its relatively cheap construction with a huge ventilation capacity and the possibility to collect the runoff or the rainwater. So it at this moment, price quality ratio of this system is very favorable for the RAS, which is one of the big standards now in the Netherlands, especially. And the last I've shown this a couple of weeks ago as well. Maybe this is our future for our long gains. I really believe that it works if you have enough light level and if you are producing in summer only. So if you want to be very early or very late, it will not be light enough. But if you have a summer production and you can do this under solar panels for raspberries, because normally you need to shade in the summertime, the solar panels give you the natural shade. I think this is a very nice combination, a very sustainable combination of different methods, solar panels plus the long cane production of raspberries. So I think we come to the end. It's a quick overview of long cane production raspberries. Those that want to know more about the irrigation and fertigation, I would invite to visit the webinar of tomorrow, Thursday the 18th, that we have from B2B Subsets. You see the, I think Kevin will be able to share the link for this this webinar. And if you need any more information, you can contact us directly or visit our website. And for the moment, I would say thank you very much. And then we go to the Q&A right now. Thank you.